I'm Sanya. I work at Exascale, they're a cloud hosting provider, and my Twitter handle is thoughtkettle. And we'll jump right into using desktop Linux as your only operating system. I'm guessing all of you use Windows so far, and it's your first time using Linux, right?
No.
Yeah. So basically, what we're going to talk about is not how to use Thunderbird. We're going to talk about why Linux, and a little bit of maybe how to convince your company to let you bring your own device and have Linux on it. Okay, let's start with the why. First, there's a big community, as we all know. It's open source, it's free, and there's a lot to learn about it. Hardware-wise and software-wise, if you do Linux, there's no chance you won't learn some of the basics. Even if you use very, very beginner distributions, you're still going to be able to learn a lot, and it's going to help with even Windows and macOS. And if you're a developer, Linux is the best system to develop on, because most of the tools, most of the things we use are based on Linux anyway. So let's start with when to use Linux. Basically, we can use it at home. We can use it at uni and school, where we have to use it most of us anyway, if you study computer science and stuff like that. And at work, it's when you bring your own device. Luckily, at my company, we all use Linux. Some of us use macOS because they want to, but most of us use Linux. And it's pretty nice. It's actually my first job where I can use Linux. Before, it had to be Windows, and the BIOS was restricted, so you couldn't even do dual boot. Where is Linux nowadays? It's on servers, mostly. I mean, there are Windows servers, but most of us are probably working with Linux servers. And containers like Docker are also a subset of Linux. Although Android, for example, it runs on the Linux kernel, it just has other stacks on it than a normal Linux distribution. And of course, it's on many more devices. The Internet of Things is mostly always running on the Linux kernel. And of course, we want it really bad now, so let's talk about it. Be careful what you push for though. Once you start Linux, it's really hard to go back. So, what is a Linux distribution? For the minimalists, there's a Linux kernel, and this is what you can either compile yourself. For example, if you use distributions like Gentoo, you will compile the kernel yourself. And that is not as intimidating as it sounds. So basically, you start up the kernel configuration, and then you choose the modules that you want in. There's mostly a default configuration, so you will have a basic kernel that works. If you have special devices, special hardware, you're gonna also have to activate the drivers for that. If you want a really minimal one, you'll have to activate everything yourself. But it's basically just clicking the help function, the question mark, and then it'll be explained what it is. As long as you know what your hardware is, which you can, then the kernel configuration is not as hard as it sounds. Then on top of the Linux kernel, every distribution has their daemons that do the logging and that just basically tell all the other services when to start up, additional drivers, and the package manager. For every distribution, or for most distribution groups, there are different package managers. Of course, you can also compile stuff from source. And on top of that is the display server, if you want to use anything graphical. So it was X a long time ago. Now they're working on Wayland, and Ubuntu has, by the way, also dropped Unity, for those of you who didn't know. On top of the display server, there's usually a desktop environment, starting with a window manager. So the desktop environment usually does not usually includes everything from a file explorer to scripts that take screenshots, to wallpaper abilities, which are not included in the window manager most of the time. For example, if you use OpenBox, it's not a desktop environment, it's just a window manager. It enables you to open windows and work within the applications. And on top of that are applications. So that's a really minimal Linux distribution. The ones we use nowadays have more on top, of course. If you can't decide for a Linux distribution, there's DistroWatch. It's a really old school site with lots of information on Linux distributions. And on the right side, you usually have a page hit ranking, so you see which distributions are favored at the moment. It was 2010, it was mostly Ubuntu and Debian, Nowadays it's Mint, then Debian, then Manjaro, which is based on Arch Linux, and then it's Ubuntu. And more complicated Linux distributions like Gentoo are far behind on rank 44 today, I think, or something like that. But I can really recommend them if you want to learn a lot about Linux. But basically, my laptop currently runs Ubuntu because it was pre-installed on the Dell laptop, and it's pretty nice because you can just start up the laptop and it works. Manjaro and Mint work just the same, but if you want to use a custom distribution and really minimize your system, you will have to go a little deeper. So, who knows this map? Okay, it's not so many actually. Basically, this is the Linux world map. It can be found on this site. It is the version 2. There's a version 1.2, and you basically see the distributions as a world map. So we have the Red Hat continent and the Debian continent with the Mint Forest and Ubuntu Fortress. So basically, a lot of it is a little play with words about how the distributions are actually used and maintained. So we have the Gentoo Pirates, for example, because with Gentoo you really do stuff from scratch. You have to compile everything, but compiling everything just means using the commands that are inside Gentoo. So Gentoo Pirates, for example, we have the Sea of Rivalry, because a lot of the Debian distributions are really rivaling against each other, and there's a lot of fights in between the communities. So Red Hat is mostly a nice continent where people play along quite well most of the time. Fedora Land, of course, the open source distribution for the Red Hat system. So what else do we have? OpenSUSE Bay. Oh yeah, UEFI Storms, which is understandable for everyone who has set up their BIOS. And basically, there's legacy BIOS. For people who are dual booting, you will all have delved into the BIOS. So UEFI is newer. It's for the last years, most BIOS have UEFI enabled, and you have to let them play along with how you partition and how you format your hard drive. That goes a little far, but we can talk about it after the talk if you're interested. And the sea of excuses, which is also really nice, especially on this map. So basically, I encourage you, everyone, to look at the world map a little bit. It's really interesting. And yeah, we can have a little discussion after the talk. It's not going to be that long, so we can do a little meetup style discussion. So applications for daily usage. Browser. Everyone uses the browser, and a lot of the applications are browser-based. So there's almost no excuse to not use Linux anymore, since everything runs in the browser most of the time. What we are using apps for, or what we were using apps for but are not doing it anymore, are, for example, email, instant messaging, working environment, and entertainment. So let's go a little bit through them. Probably a lot of you know Mozilla Thunderbird still. It still looks like this. I made a screenshot this morning about it, so this is what it still looks like. But almost all the applications look like that. So there are several extensions for calendar extensions and stuff if you really want to use the app. But I guess most of us are probably in the browser with either a private email service or Gmail, some of us, stuff like that. Who is actually using an email app still? Okay, nice. Which one do you use, for example? Okay, Thunderbird, yeah, okay. It works well. Then we have IRC. In my company, we do actually use IRC for team communication, yes. We do use IRC. We don't use Slack for obvious reasons of privacy and not wanting our data anywhere else. And basically, if you want to look up a bit on Slack, there's enough information on the internet about why to not use Slack. I won't go into that. But IRC still is on-premise. You install your own server. You can have your own bouncer so that you're always online. And when you log in, you still see the old messages. And there are a lot of integrations with several bots so that you can use IRC to full potential, even though it's very old. GIMP, for everything that's like cropping images, working with photos, enhancing the photos, doing the contrast and stuff, Photoshop is not needed. GIMP, I've been using GIMP since, I think, 2001. and Inkscape as well. Inkscape is a vector illustration program. I think I started using that in 2002 or 2003. So basically for 15 years, GIMP and Inkscape, I don't know exactly how long they've been around, but definitely for over 15 years. And it looks like this. There is a single window mode now. I don't know how long that's been introduced, but this is what I use, because if you start up GIMP, don't be afraid at first. It's a lot of windows. And there's a setting in the settings. You can, in the, I think it's window, and then you do single window mode, and then it's all good, because the rest is pretty much like in any other application. And this is what I used to crop the screenshots that I made, for example. So we can talk a little about the applications after the talk, so it's a little more interactive. But the biggest problem that people have with Linux is the terminal, which, who of you are developers, if I can ask? Okay, yeah, so you know you have to use a lot of the terminal a lot of the times anyway. And basically, if you type terminal cheat sheet in DuckDuckGo or whatever search engine you're using, you will get all the commands that you can use. For example, change directory, cd, stuff like that. Once you have the 5-6 most basic terminal usage things, you're fine. But you don't need them. For a normal Linux distribution, you have your file explorer just like you have in Windows and Mac, except it doesn't do any weird file names. For example, if you use macOS, it will create DS store files that are unnecessary, and it will create duplicates of almost every file that you use. So you will have a lot of 4 kilobyte files that are hidden, and once you, for example, move away from macOS and you put it on a backup, you will have a lot of redundant files that you need then a script to get rid of them. Windows isn't even that bad. It only creates a few unnecessary files, but Linux doesn't do that. So, for example, for a Linux desktop usage, you will do a lot of RTFM, which is read the fucking manual. So you'll have to be able to Google or search engine your way through some stuff that isn't working, and there's going to be a lot of trial and error. But still, if you use a normal Linux distribution that doesn't require any extra knowledge, like for example Ubuntu, Mint, or Debian, you'll be fine. It's going to work. There are all the applications you need. There is LibreOffice, which is the equivalent of Microsoft Office. If you need that, some of us are going to use Google Drive probably. So basically you're set for the Linux desktop usage if you just install via a USB stick from Linux. So the other things, the more finer details of Linux when you work with it for a long time, and if you do develop or do more than just browsing, what is really recommended is putting aliases for your terminal usage. For example, you have bash aliases file in Ubuntu. For some other distributions, I think it can be named differently, so you'll have to look it up. But for Ubuntu, it's the file bash aliases in your home folder. And if you, for example, create that and then open up a terminal, then you can say, I want, for example, the alias LA to be LS minus AF, which means you will show all the hidden files in the folder where you're at right now. And the F means you'll have the folders with a slash, so you'll know exactly what you're looking at in the terminal. So I have only a few aliases, but some people have more. I often SSH into my web server, so I actually have an alias for that, so I don't have to always put that up. I have several longer file destinations that I need, so I have extra names for that. For example, if you have your video editing environment often in CD, home, backup, videos, movies, media, files, then you'll probably want to CD movies, and you'll have an alias movies that'll point to that folder. So aliases are definitely recommended. And once you go a little deeper into Linux, you will probably want to copy your configs. So when you have the alias file, don't forget to backup. Once you change distribution or so, you can reuse it for any Linux distribution, also for macOS, because the aliases and the commands are the same. So basically, you will have, for example, this is a copy of my make config for Gentoo, where you're not gonna need that for anything else with Gentoo. I'm just showing it once. It was, I don't know, I think 10 to 15 hours got it, went into this make-conf, but once it's there, you reuse it all the time. So there are, for example, use flags in Gen 2. There are use flags in every Linux distribution, but only with Gen 2, when you compile the packages each time, you actually use the use flags. And the use flags indicate what, how you want to compile the program. For example, you don't need parts of this or this or this, so you don't have the use flags enabled, and the package will compile to be minimal, which you don't have with Ubuntu. You have binaries, they are installed, and that's it. This is why Ubuntu is a little bigger, a little more bloated, it's a little slower, but it's also more reliable, more stable, and there's more support in the Ubuntu forums because more people use it. So basically, this is a make-conf, but there's a lot of other configs that you can have, like the bash alias, the bash profile, where you have your paths for developing. There are at least 4 to 5 config files, once you go a little deeper, that you always have to want to copy. And then there are helper scripts that you write with distributions that are a little trickier. For example, I have this repository for myself, where I have, okay, so once I had a laptop where the buttons for brightness up and brightness down didn't work on my laptop, so it was always full brightness. So you go and look it up how to actually do the brightness. So you map the buttons for the brightness to a script that then executes the brightness down and brightness up. I can show you what the scripts look like. And then an MTS converter. I had a video camera that would only save things as MTS, which was unusable with most media players. So I wrote a converter that uses FFmpeg to convert them, and I just run the script in the folder where all the MTS files are, and then it's done. And it's the same as any application would do, except you define your parameters yourself. The same happened with AVConf, which was in Ubuntu, because there's an equivalent with FFmpeg, you have to use AVConf in Ubuntu for a while. So there's two scripts. And then there's scripts so that you can convert letters to upper and lowercase, and a WAV to MP3 script. So basically, a lot of these scripts are found online, and then you can just tweak them. And it's really nice to start and empower yourself and learn a bit more, because if you don't, you can still use the system just like you would use Windows or macOS. Now, the good news about Linux is Microsoft is now supposedly embracing open source, so a lot of the things they create are compatible with what we want to use. And a lot of people that I know that use MacBooks for a long time now can't live without the applications on macOS, so they're building Hackintosh. So basically, they buy a lot of components, they build their own computer, and then they install macOS on them. With the knowledge they're actually using, they could also use Linux and just maybe learn a bit of Inkscape, for example, instead of using the proprietary application on macOS. So this is the good news, that people are actually shifting to Linux now, there's more interest. File transfer is not a problem anymore. There's standards are actually being used nowadays. So wherever you import your docx file that you got from work, you will be able to open it in LibreOffice or even in Google Docs. Edit it and then save it back and send it the same way you got it. For gaming, because this was a big thing back then. With the Linux, you can't game on it, so you had to have Windows in order to be able to game. But there's SteamOS now, it's Linux-based, and you can play a lot of really nice games on the Linux machines, so it's basically not an excuse to use Windows anymore either. And there's many specialized applications which are only available on Linux or cross-platform. Something like Open Broadcaster Studio, which we're using to record this talk, for example, can be used on macOS, Windows, and Linux. And there's a lot of applications like that, like Inkscape or GIMP, which you can use on all the platforms. So basically, we've covered a little bit of the Linux desktop, which most of you probably already knew. Keeping your data safe is one more aspect, for example, if you want to convince your company to let you use Linux. Keeping your data safe is not Linux's job, and it's not Microsoft's job especially, or Apple's job, and no one can do it for you. So if you use any cloud service and then, for example, have all your keys somewhere else where people can get access to it, then it doesn't matter if the cloud itself is private or if anything else has really good security, because the people are the most error prone, and the fault tolerance and replication of any database doesn't help if the users have their passwords still on post-its. It still happens, actually. So in order to keep your data safe, you will need good passwords, as you know, and password handling. So a lot of people recommend password managers, but a few months ago there was a breach in, I think it was 1Password. Was it 1Password? Does anyone know? There are several password managers, and I think it was 1Password that got the data stolen. So it doesn't help if you only have to type in a master password and then see all your passwords, if the actual password manager that is somewhere on someone's computer is hacked. So what you can do is, for example, partition one folder within your hard drive or have it on a USB that you're sure is not going to get stolen, encrypt that, have a decryption key, and then have your passwords on that, which is basically your own password manager without having it hosted somewhere. There's always the option of your USB key getting stolen, stuff like that, but at least you'll know, because if something gets hacked, you probably don't know. Even though there's a new EU data regulation, data protection regulation, which is turning active in May 2018, where all the companies have to, I think within a certain time frame, I don't know exactly the hours, the 72 hours, a few days, where they have to report every breach that has happened to them. It's just that sometimes they don't know when they've been hacked. So the thing is to never trust anything that has your data, unless you're sure to be able to recover it, have it encrypted, or something like that. So you have to use the right services. You have to know how they handle their data, how they handle security incidents, and especially where the servers are located also. Two-factor authentication is also a thing that you can use with most services, which is actually helpful. Most of the services nowadays have it, GitHub included, and Gmail and other services. So basically you use your phone to also authenticate with the password. Yagni is, you ain't gonna need it. And the thing is, if you don't need a service, don't just sign up. Think about the services that you're signing up for, and also check whether your data can be deleted. Most of them still save your data, and most of them still just deactivate your account. So you have to make sure when you sign up somewhere, either use a pseudonym, don't even use your real name, don't use your real data, unless you know it's a service you can trust. And for most services, you know you can't. So this was a little detour into security software-wise, but then there's still the thing if your laptop gets stolen. And on your work laptop, most of us with work maybe have a Windows laptop, which means that for most companies that do actually value security, they will have BitLocker enabled, which encrypts the whole hard drive. The same goes for macOS with FileVault. You encrypt your hard drive, and then companies think it's safe. But the thing is, you have a key. Once you encrypt the hard drive, you will get a key, and only with that key, someone is able to decrypt your hard drive. The thing is that you mostly send the key via unencrypted email to your system administrator, and then, so you have your hardware key in an unencrypted email that is sent over the internet to a system administrator who saves it, you don't know where, and that's your hardware encryption. So if someone is really out to get your data, and you know, being paranoid doesn't mean they're not after you. So basically, when you have really sensitive data, you will not want to share your key with anyone else. The problem with disk encryption now is that if you lose the encryption key, it's lost. Unless you have, for example, stuff like cold boot attacks where the key that you're using is actually still in the RAM. So if after a short time after shutting down the computer, it's still gonna be in the RAM. So you can freeze the RAM, and this is called a cold boot attack. So you can still get the key out of it and decrypt the data. The problem is if you don't encrypt your disk, which is fine for most of us, if you don't decrypt it, people can just hook a live USB, Linux USB, for example, into your laptop and just access the hard drive. So if something goes wrong with Windows, you will still be able to just use your Linux USB drive and access all your data on your hard drive. You can't do that once it's encrypted. So it also makes some parts slower, so the input and output will be slower. And the problem is if you only encrypt the files, like for example the home folder, stuff that you used or files that you accessed can still be in RAM or in the temp folder or in the swap partition. So there is a certain area of it's safe if you encrypt your home folder, but you maybe have more sensitive data, then you have to encrypt your whole disk, take care of the keys. Most of us will probably not use it, but it's good to know. So about disk encryption, there's a lot of information on the Arch Linux and the Gentoo Wiki about it. There is gmcrypt, which is mostly used for encrypting your disk drive on Linux, like BitLocker and FireVault on the others. From Google, there's an open source, sort of like a broker or an escrow, a Troy handle sort of. It's called Cauliflower Vest, and it was first made for FireVault, but now they extended it to also support BitLocker and Linux, so dmcrypt based on the looks. And the thing is, so you can use it with any operating system of the free, and it takes your keys, it saves them to, for example, any server that you have that is safe, so that you always have your keys available. The code is open source, and you use it from your own servers, so as long as the web connection you use for this is safe, you're safe with the key, wherever you save it. And that's it for the talk. Thank you very much. And let's just go to the interactive part of it, with questions and stuff like that. This is a poem I wrote in 2013, because I had used 5 years of exclusively Linux, and then I started working at HP, and I had to use a Windows laptop. And I was so frustrated the first workday that I wrote this. But yeah, so, questions? Still reading? Questions, anyone?
So what do you suggest to new users who don't know much about the operating systems because you have a script for turning the brightness up and down?
Also,
and
so the thing is, I'll just show you a bit of my system with Ubuntu, and I can really recommend Ubuntu or Mint, which are Debian based. So for really new users, there are tools that you just really download and have your ISO that you also download from the distribution site. For a very new user, I will just show it like this. Let's close this down and go to the browser. So, for a very, very new user, you would do this. You would, for example, go to Ubuntu. So you go to Ubuntu and then you want to download it. And I would really recommend to start with one of those so-called easy distributions, because they do work out of the box most of the time. So you will go to download, and you will just download this. And then what will happen is you will have an ISO file that you need to get to a bootable USB stick. So the bootable USB stick means that you just have any flash drive, you plug it in, and then there's a tool like UNet boot in. Do you use Linux right now, or?
The question was, why did you have to use the brightness shell script?
Oh, because I use Gentoo, so okay. I put Gentoo on a Linux laptop, and it just didn't work.
Okay.
It just, the keys didn't work, I didn't know what to do, and I probably didn't install a kernel module I needed, so.
It's not a general Linux program, just a...
Yeah, that's the thing. Yeah?
The main suggestion here is get a laptop that behaves well. Do a little research, buy it 3 months after it comes out, and usually you're fine.
Yeah. There are special Linux laptops like System 76 sells Linux laptops. My Dell laptop, for example, I bought it a few months ago. It's really working well with the Linux. You just have to do some research. Yeah, and that really works fine. So I have a scripts and configs thing that I showed before. And for example, this is what the brightness down and brightness up. So I bound the key, one key to brightness down and one key to brightness up. And this is the whole thing. But for several distributions, this would be different. So you'll have to find where this actually is. It's just a value that puts a brightness amount to the monitor. That's it. And then you just have to play around a bit with that. So there's a lot of scripts like that to use. I actually also had a screenshot script because I used OpenBox and I didn't know how to take screenshots. So I had to do a screenshot script, which is easy if you just type screenshot script. Okay, well, we'll have to somehow define that to Linux. And then you find most of the scripts, and then you can just adapt them if they don't work for you. And yeah, also, most of the time you'll have a lot of libraries being shown to you about what you can use. So install them, and you just use the little thing. So if you really want a minimal system, you'll have to Google for desktop environments, and then see what actually is in a desktop environment. It could be a window manager, a file explorer, things to create wallpapers, take screenshots, view images, and that's how you build your own little system based on the distribution. Any other questions?
Yeah. What resources can you recommend for beginners when they want to look up? Because there are always some details. It's the little things that interfere you in working.
Yeah.
As long as you stay in the GUI, it's not a big deal. But it's things like you have to go to the bash or just the drives. It's different, the system in Linux and in Windows.
Yeah.
So what resources can you recommend for ordinary users to look up?
So when I started out, I really just, whatever I needed, I put it in a search engine, because there is no one resource that really covers everything. But for a little more, like for learning things from the start, I can recommend the Gentoo Handbook. Because if you start with that, you will know, you will get to know all the terms slowly. They have steps described. I don't know, have you seen the Gentoo Handbook? Once you start with that, it really explains everything from scratch. So basically, I learned the hard way with Gentoo, but before that I used SUSE and Red Hat and Fedora and Ubuntu and all kinds of things. So the handbook is actually really good. Most of the time you will find everything in the Arch and Gentoo, in the Arch and Gentoo wiki, and it's really well described. So for example, this already looks a little bit hard actually, but if you know your system, it's AMD64 most likely, and then you just start. It says how to install it, and from there you really learn a lot. It will probably take 4 to 5 days. It took me about a week to really go through the handbook properly. I mean, it can be done in a day, but if you really Google deeper and want to know more, you'll probably end up having a whole week. But after that week, you're an expert, and you really know what to Google after that, what to search for. There's really, yep.
FanTuFoil has a very good introduction documentation that they usually give colleagues. And
yeah, it's like Gentoo but fun too.
Nobody wants to kill me yet, so it seems to work.
Yeah.
FanTuFoil. Oh.
Yeah, Spaß.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Anything? Yeah.
What do you think about Red Hat Desktop?
It's good. It's very stable. But it's a little behind the modern. So you're not gonna get the newest packages with it. And it's actually very complicated to use it as a user, because you'll have to work a lot more to get the modern packages and to get the to get the newest stuff, the updated stuff. You'll have to actually work more than if you use another system. but for work, and for companies who want to ensure that everything's working fine, in that sense, it's good. Is there a special motivation behind the question?
It's also because I want to use a Red Hat server.
Yeah.
Enterprise server, and I think that the connection between them and
Yeah, for companies, Red Hat can definitely be recommended because it's really, really stable and there's really good support. So, definitely good.
But for private purpose, also Magea or OSA, they are also Red Hat based.
Magea is really good. Magea also looks pretty nice, and it's when I tried it in 2013 or 14, it was actually really nice. It looked like a better Windows system, actually. Yeah. No, it's based on Mandrake.
Yes, Mandrake is based on Red Hat.
That's true. Yes.
So I'm one of those MacBook Pro users who need to upgrade sooner or later, but they're too expensive and I want an alternative. But I'm used to all of the Apple sugar, like the really nice four buttons.
So I hit you right.
Right? So I want all of the gestures from my trackpad, right?
Yeah.
You mentioned System 76 earlier.
Yeah.
Is that going to give me a kind of a good idea of which hardware is going to give me the most?
Yeah. If you check the specs of the System 76 models, or the Dell Linux models, basically anything with Linux laptops, you will get the... But there's also a website on what hardware works really well with Linux. Linux hardware laptops, if you just put it in a search engine, you will get the specs of every motherboard that works really well, every graphic card.
Yeah, so that in terms of the hardware, usually that kind of thing, you can, like you say, you can Google it and find it, but I'm concerned with things like user input, because If I want to use a Magic Trackpad, normally things like those gestures and swipes and whatnot, which I do find useful, I don't want to give them up.
I know there are drivers. I actually had a Logitech trackpad that didn't work on Linux, but that was many years ago.
Mm.
So the first version of the trackpad worked with multi-gestures and the second one didn't. So you'll have to really check for the hardware that you want to use and then check what is out there. And there are alternatives too. For example, this one was really cheap and works perfectly with Linux. There's even a touchpad and everything, so it's kind of cool. But you'll have to check out the hardware that you want to use.
Yeah, then the additional question, I did have another one, I forgot on it, frankly.
Apps?
No.
There are some things that you really need other systems for. Like, for example, if you do music processing, artificial intelligence stuff, there are some libraries that just work on macOS.
Yeah, that's a very specific.
That is such a specific use case that you're like, okay, go in peace.
So I have a MacBook Pro now.
Yeah.
Is it? Can I, for example, get a bootable USB and use that as my OS, Linux OS?
Mm-hmm. You just have to make sure that something's persistent. Basically, you can have an extra partition on the USB stick that is dedicated to stuff you want to save.
Oh yeah, I hear you. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
I would like to remind you, there's a whole web behind or beyond search engines.
Yeah.
So people from the older times, like me, we learned to, or we used to solve problems by understanding the reasons.
Yep.
And therefore is a great resource called the Linux Documentation Project, which is a rich collection of how-tos and guides for specific problems. Hardware related, for if you want to do certain tasks like video editing or text processing.
Yep.
And they are distribution agnostic and for people who like to understand the basics and do the work afterwards.
This is Gösta, by the way, he's leading the Linux User Group Austria, one of the leaders. So, hi. I also have the Vienna Linux meetup for those who want to get a little more of the Linux and open source info. But yeah, basically, we have the groups. So, talk to us afterwards. But yeah, the Linux documentation is a good tip. Thanks. Any other questions? Or stuff you want to talk about? Yeah?
Yeah, just, are there any shops in Vienna that like help with the support? Or like companies that do IT support, the Linux desktops?
For an affordable amount of money, not.
You're a pet Red Hat, don't you?
Hmm?
You're a pet Red Hat.
No, Red Hat is actually one of the better ones. No, they're good actually. It's just that most of the stuff you'll find here are consultants, and they're just expensive.
There's a project from here, from Austria, it's called Freie IT. These are freelancers doing support for ordinary people. So if you don't want company-grade support,
yeah,
but just help from day-to-day problems, just look for freie.it.
Okay.
It's from the Free Software Foundation guys.
It just helps for anyone who wants to install Linux on their laptop and just everyday kind of thing, not like enterprise grade.
This is a resource where you can hire Linux experts who help ordinary people.
Cool. That's
don't
cool.
Charge you by consultant rates, yeah. And don't give you a contract for support for years, 24/7
yeah.
Stuff, but just human to human support.
Oh, great. Thanks a lot.
That's nice.
And there's the Linux user groups, of course.
Yes, that's actually useful at the Linux user group. At the Vienna Linux Meetup, we mostly have talks and stuff about open source, about Linux. So next time it's going to be a presentation on NixOS, but last time we had OpenShift, so it's really varied. And the Linux user group is a lot of real help and really Linux focused on the distributions, right?
Yes.
Yeah, and a lot of discussions. Well then, that's it. Thank you. Have a nice weekend.